Hello viewers, my name is Vijay Shekhar. I am working in Research Center for E-Governance at IIIT Hyderabad, and today's lesson is on Central Secretariat. Introduction. The composition and functions of the Central Secretariat of the present day would be worthwhile to have a glimpse into its origin. The Central Secretariat, like quite a few other administrative organizations, is a legacy of the British rule in India. Before the year 1756, the President and the Council at Fort William transacted all their business in one single department with the help of a secretary and a few assistants. After the packets had reached from England, the secretary laid them before the council for orders and instructions. When such orders and instructions were issued, they were conveyed to the authorities concerned for execution. Thus, the Central Secretariat at Fort William in Bengal was designed to furnish the requisite information for the formulation of policy and to carry out the orders of the company's government. Later, both Lord Cornwallis and Lord Wellesley contributed towards organizing the secretariat. In the year 1919, the famous Montague-Chelmsford reforms were made, which eventually divided the secretariat functions between the central and provincial governments. With the outbreak of World War II in the year 1939, the government had to assume several new functions and burdens. Special officers were appointed to meet the exigencies of the time, which led to the rapid expansion of the administrative machinery. The total strength of the secretariat, which was 29 in 1919, increased to 200 during the period of World War II. Since independence in 1947, the Government of India announced its various welfare programs, leading to a marked increase in the number of offices and ministries. To cope with the increasing workload, more and more personnel were recruited. This was done by promotion from lower ranks and also through emergency recruitment. Under the Constitution of India, all executive actions of the Union government are taken in the name of the President. But the President is a mere formal and constitutional head. There is a Council of Ministers with the Prime Minister at its head to aid and advise the President in the exercise of his functions. Thus, the real executive authority is vested in the cabinet or the summation of ministers with the Prime Minister acting as the nucleus. These ministers obviously cannot perform such huge number of functions and hence they need assistance. Therefore, for purpose of administrative convenience, the Government of India is divided into ministries and departments, which together constitute what is known as the Central Secretariat. Subordinate offices and other field agencies are attached to implement policies enunciated by the ministers in consultation with the secretariat. Now, meaning, nature, functions, and role. The word secretariat literally means the office of the secretary. The central government has three essential organs. A, the ministers. B, the secretary. And C, administrative head. The most important function of the minister is to make the policy. The secretary's duty is to provide necessary materials by which such decisions can be reached and implemented. The executive head performs the function of carrying the decisions into effect. Orders and instructions issued by the central secretariat are regarded as the order of the Government of India. Hence, in the administrative setup, the central secretariat occupies a key position. The central secretariat is the summation of various ministers, departments of the union government. Just like the Council of Ministers, the central secretariat also works as a single unit with collective responsibility. Secretaries constituting the central secretariat are secretaries to the union government as a whole and not to any particular minister. The main function of the central secretariat is to assist and advise the ministers regarding the following matters: making and modifying policies from time to time, framing laws, rules and regulations, formulating sectoral planning and programs, budgeting and controlling expenses, supervising and controlling the execution of policies and programs by field agencies and evaluating results, coordinating and interpreting policies, assisting other branches of the government and maintaining contacts with state administrators, initiating measures to develop greater organizational competence, discharging their responsibilities to the parliament, describing the real status of the central secretariat. Ashok Chanda observes, the central secretariat is the principal executive instrument of the union government and is responsible for administering the central subjects, coordinating the activities of national importance and assisting in the formulation of foreign, economic and financial policies. Thus, the central secretariat plays two kinds of roles simultaneously. On the one hand, it is a policy making, coordinating and supervisory agency. And on the other hand, it is the main executive agency of the government. The central secretariat is concerned with every details of administration. The functions and responsibilities of the central secretariat have been rapidly increasing. Naturally, its authority has grown too. The superior position of the central secretariat is recognized by the fact that the secretariat personnel are being given higher grades of salaries than their counterparts working in field agencies. In fact, the field officers are entitled to special payment immediately after they join the central secretariat. It seems that the prestige of the central secretariat has gone up too high. Structure. It is said that the central secretariat is the summation of various ministries and departments, but cabinet secretariat, which is a ministry comprising more than one department, is still known as the secretariat. In a ministry, the ultimate charge is allotted to a minister. This charge may include one or more departments. Each department is under the charge of one secretary. Many large ministers like agriculture, defense, education, external affairs, finance, home, etc. have more than one department in their charge. A department, on the other hand, is defined as an organizational unit consisting of a secretary. Thus, a department should be identified with a secretary's charge and a ministry should be identified with a minister's charge. A ministry for the purpose of expenditure, internal organizational activities is divided into the following segments. There is an officer in charge of each segment, department secretary, additional secretary, special secretary, wings, joint secretary, additional secretary. For divisions, director, deputy secretary. For branches, under secretary. For sections, section officer. The functions and roles played by such officers are briefly listed below. Secretary. A secretary is usually the administrative head of a ministry or a department. He is the main advisor to the minister on all matters of policy and administration within his ministry or department. He enjoys complete and undivided responsibility for efficient administration. The secretary represents his ministry or department before the Parliamentary Committee on Public Accounts. He receives weekly summaries describing the nature of cases which have been disposed of by his subordinate officers. Thus, he becomes continuously aware of the working of his department. M. Gopalaswamy Iyengar suggested a secretary should not be immersed in files and burdened with routine. It is essential that he should have time to grasp the overall picture, size up the problems facing government in the field allotted to his charge, and think and plan ahead. All these are his proper functions and must be efficiently performed. Thus, the secretary stands at the topmost point of the departmental authority and draws the highest salary available to any member of the civil service. Number 2, special secretary. More than one level of authority has been introduced since 1947, and thus the original hierarchy of administration has been disturbed. This tends to weaken the solidarity, efficiency and effectiveness of a number of administrative posts. The introduction of a new post designated as special secretary is a good example of such weakening. As Ashok Chandra observes, in 1951, a special secretary enjoying the pay, status and authority of a secretary was appointed to the Ministry of Agriculture. This was a unique post where neither the principles on which such a post was created nor its relations with the permanent secretary were defined. A special secretary was also appointed with the rank of secretary in charge of the Department of Kashmir Affairs in the Ministry of Home Affairs. It can thus be said that there is no well-defined principle regarding the appointment, rank and pay of a special secretary. Number 3, additional secretary. Initially, the officer next in hierarchy to the secretary was the deputy secretary. But later, some new levels of joint, additional and special secretaries were formed. In 1937, the Organization and Procedure Committee referred to these new levels. Almost every committee has recommended either the abolition of these new posts or their drastic reduction in number. However, such newer intermediary ranks have ultimately succeeded. In reality, these posts have been created to reward some senior joint secretary by raising both his salary and rank. This new officer has no specified duty or work. Sometimes he is placed in charge of a department, doing the work of a secretary. All other times, he is placed at the head of a wing and performs the functions of a joint secretary. Still, at other times, he helps the secretary in a specified field of activity. In the opinion of Richard Tottenham, there is and should be no difference of functions, but only a pay between a joint secretary and an additional secretary. In both cases, their real function is to lighten the burden of the secretary. However, the personal study team of the Administrative Reforms Commission and the ARC itself suggested the creation of defined level of additional secretary. Thus, in the secretariat hierarchy, the level of additional secretary has come to stay. This level provides considerable relief to the secretary in the ministries of large size. As a result, the secretary can now concentrate on the more important policy matters. Number 4, joint secretary. Where the volume of work in a ministry exceeds the manageable charge of a secretary, one or more wings may be established within the ministry. Normally, a joint secretary takes in charge of each wing regarding all business falling under his wing. The joint secretary is in charge of maximum measure of independent functioning and responsibility. For three main reasons, this post of joint secretary was created in the early 20s of the 20th century. They are as under. The functions of some departments were enhanced so remarkably that it became extremely difficult for one secretary to deal with all the increasing work. For one secretary, it became really difficult to combine separate items of business. With the emergence of two houses of legislature at the center in the year 1920, it was necessary that senior officers should be present in both houses to assist the members of the legislature in the legislative work. Criticizing the emergence of the new level of joint secretaries between the secretary and the deputy secretaries, Gopalaswamy Iyengar has observed the interposition of an officer called so-called joint or additional secretaries between the secretary and the deputy secretary in a department is prima facie an unsatisfactory arrangement, even when it is made for the purpose for which it should normally be made, namely to relieve the secretary of a block of work and deal directly with the minister in respect of that work. Even at its best, I consider the arrangement to be unsatisfactory because the secretary is not thereby formally relieved of his general or de jure responsibility, while de facto responsibility is entrusted to another officer. Number 5, director. This post is relatively a new addition since it was created in 1960, mostly to satisfy the ego of certain officers. The post of director was created. The responsibilities of directors are more or less the same as those of a deputy secretary. Number 6, deputy secretary. A deputy secretary is an officer acting on behalf of the secretary. He is in charge of the secretariat division. He remains responsible for the performance of governmental functions within his territorial jurisdiction. He should be able to dispose of the majority of cases coming up to him. On more important cases where the secretary or the joint secretary gives him written or oral orders, the deputy secretary uses his discretionary powers in taking such orders. On the whole, the deputy secretary occupies a key position in the central secretariat. Point number 7, under secretary. An under secretary is in charge of a branch in a ministry and has full authority regarding the dispatch of business and the maintenance of discipline. In the Maxwell Committee report, the role of the under secretary has been clearly mentioned in the following way. The grade of the under secretary should ordinarily initiate action on all inward communications, but he should not hesitate even at that stage to bring a receipt immediately to the notice of the deputy secretary for any instructions which the latter might wish to give more important files he should submit to the deputy secretary in such a form that in ordinary course the deputy secretary should be enabled to deal with the case quite briefly. Under secretaries should also attempt to reduce the number of files to be formally submitted to the deputy secretary. Point number 8, assistant secretary. Till our independence in the year 1947, there was another level below the under secretary. This level was known as the assistant secretary. These posts were created as a result of the recommendation of the Secretariat Committee of 1919. The Maxwell report, however, recommended for the abolition of the post. The recommendation was effected after the year 1947. Point number 9, officer on special duty, OSD. It is an old device to accommodate certain persons or to meet an unexpected emergency, but it has appeared to be useful to practicing administrators. Certain features inherent in the system are as follows. The designation OSD has a special charm which attracts a lot of persons. The post does not indicate any status. It means any position at a given time depending on the nature and type of work. The government in recent years has been appointing OSDs more easily and frequently than originally envisaged. There is a growing trend towards such officers staying on in their special posts indefinitely. The post is of a temporary nature. It suits both the officer concerned and his boss. The post is ideal for training. In the words of S.R. Maheshwari, the post of OSD ideally tends itself to use as a training post. The post has both administrative reasons and political reasons behind its creation. Point number 10, section officer. Superintendents in charge of sections are known as section officers. The section officer basically supervises the work of the staff of his section, but he himself handles the important and intricate cases. He distributes the work among his staff, trains, assists, and advises the staff, coordinates the work in his section, ensuring prompt and efficient disposal of work in his section. He adopts necessary measures for the steady progress of cases. He submits arrears statements and other periodical returns in time. And he maintains the section diary, file register, and other documents of the section properly. He ensures safeguarding of secret and top secret papers. He issues reminders, acknowledgements, etc. It remains responsible for the disposal of routine cases, maintains order and discipline in the section, and keeps the section neat and clean. Apart from the above mentioned officers, this section will describe the functions of the assistants and upper division clerks on the one hand and lower division clerks and typists on the other. Number 1, assistants and upper division clerks. An assistant usually works under the orders of the section officer. The assistant usually remains responsible for the work entrusted to him by the section officer. He normally examines and puts suitable notes and drafts on case promptly and submit them quickly to his immediate boss. That means the section officer, he maintains his diary properly and keeps papers and files in tidy condition. Some assistants may be selected as more efficient ones who are usually authorized to submit cases directly to the branch officer. Upper division clerks perform more or less similar functions as with those of assistants, but they are not ordinarily entitled to deal with important cases as the assistants are. Number 2, lower division clerks and typists. Such functionaries are normally entrusted with work of a routine nature. This work includes registration of papers, maintenance and circulation of other registers, indexing, recording, proof corrections, preparation of arrear statements, supervision of corrections to reference books, typing, submission of routine and simple drafts, etc. There has been a remarkable increase in recent years in the volume of work in the Central Secretariat. The main reasons behind this increase are: 1. At present, the government has assumed increasing responsibilities for regulating trade and industry, controlling restrictive practices, nationalization of banking and insurance, promotion of economic development, fostering science and technology, etc. Point number 2, there has also been an increase in the number of public sector undertakings in various fields, which in turn gives birth to a steady increase in the secretarial works. Point number 3, again, due to the increasing executive accountability to the legislature and the increasing scrutiny by the standing committees of the union legislature, there is an increasing need for maintaining proper records of all cases involving financial sanctions. As a result of all these factors, there has been a remarkable growth in the number of central secretariat posts at various levels. Number 1, write an essay on the Central Secretariat and explain the importance of it. Number 2, discuss the structure and functions of Central Secretariat. Number 3, what are the functions of ministries and departments?